thanks for tuning in. My name's Itxy, and today's video is the first of the BRTC Show, which stands for Be Rebellious, Take Control, where I will be interviewing awesome teens who do awesome things with their life. So first special guest is Jonny Santana. So how are you doing, Jonny?
Great, you just call me special, so I'm glad. Yeah, I'm doing good, mostly.
Great. So why don't you tell us a little about yourself, what you do, your age?
I am turning 19 next week. And I'm a filmmaker. I've been making movies for like 10 years now of my life, and my two recent successes have been getting my first film, Fruit Juice, on Amazon Prime, which I finished at 17. And right now I'm working on The Empty Hours in post-production, and that's going to be on Netflix, and I'm planning to premiere at Sundance, the Cannes, a bunch of film festivals across the world, and really get my team and myself noticed in the film industry.
Great. Yeah. So, before I get into the specifics, you said you're a director. At what age did you realize that you wanted to become a director? Like, what inspired you?
So, I walked out of my first theater experience with my father. I was 4 years old, and it was Spider-Man. And after watching it, I looked up at my dad, you know, holding his hand, and I was like, who makes those movies? Like, what are they? Who makes them? And my dad said, movie directors. And I said, that's what I want to be. And so since then, my dad understood my passion for it, and he's actually helped me a lot and guiding me what to do. Like when I was younger, I would make like little, I would draw my movies out about Spider-Man. I would plan out movies and I would start shooting them in elementary. And yeah, I've just been working on movies my whole life. It's been the only thing I've really been committed to.
So elementary? Dang. Yeah. So who's your biggest inspiration in filmmaking? Cause like, I noticed honestly the first movie, Fruit Juice, it totally reminded me of a Quentin Tarantino movie.
Yeah.
Especially when you had the Kill Bill reference, although it was really cool.
So, my inspiration, I'll wait for the thing to pass.
Yo, let me close the door, actually.
That's cool. That's a good question, inspiration. In terms of work ethic, and necessarily, like, bringing your art as a young person to the world, Steven Spielberg made his first movie when he was 17, and when I read that as a sophomore when I was 15, I was like, whoa, if I want to be one of the greatest filmmakers of all time, as Steven Spielberg is, I need to emulate their careers. Most people wait till after they go to film school to make their first feature. I was like, why wait? I've got a pencil and a paper, I've got friends, and I've got a camera. Not the best camera, but I've got one. So I decided to do as Spielberg did and make a movie at 17 years old. And so he's an inspiration in the work ethic. Orson Welles as well. He made Citizen Kane in his early 20s. Like, there's a lot of young directors who have been very successful. They are inspirations. In regards to style, you mentioned Tarantino. I am a big fan of Tarantino. I really like Tarantino. And Fruit Juice was heavily influenced by Tarantino. But one thing that I realized after making Fruit Juice, it took me 2 years to make. It was a big sacrifice. 2 years is what? If you live 100 years, 2 years is 2% of your life. I took 2% of my life solely dedicating my whole mindset to making that movie. And when I watched it, I realized, what do I have? I just have entertainment. I realized that the whole Tarantino style, it's good, it's entertainment, it's funny, it's awesome. But if I'm going to be spending 2% of my life on a project, it needs to change the world in a way. And so I did like Tarantino, and I like him for his style. But now what I'm going for with The Empty Iris and with my future movies is art that can really change the world and help inspire humanity, rather than just make movies for entertainment. Because anybody can make movies for entertainment, but not everybody can really send a message or a word as an artist. So now my inspirations are Terrence Malick, Scorsese, and some of his more art pictures.
Yeah.
Some of the more mature filmmakers. Not that Tarantino isn't. I love you, Tarantino. I don't need to watch this.
So how do you send a message through movies?
That's a good question. What you do is you first have to find a topic and theme that's really personal to you. I'll use The Empty Iris as an example because Fruit Juice didn't really have one, had a little bit of one. But with The Empty Iris, I began writing it when I was 17. And at that moment in my life, I still don't have a girlfriend, but I've never had a girlfriend. I never felt the love, obviously from parents and friends, but not the real true love from a woman or whatever. Never felt that. Also, I was coming to terms with what adulthood was. I was like, the world isn't as innocent as I thought it was in middle school or elementary school. So the whole ideas of loss of innocence and the whole idea of unfulfillment, I wasn't happy. After Fruit Juice premiered, I thought I would feel a sense of accomplishment. As I said earlier, I thought I'd be like really happy. Wow, I got my first movie. Done. Made. It's going to be on Amazon. Yes. didn't make me happier at all. I was in the shower and I was thinking, like, I just spent 2 years of my life on that feeling of just shaking people's hands and having them applaud me. And so I realized I was unfulfilled. I've never felt loved by the opposite sex.
Yeah.
And I wasn't very happy. And so what you have to first do to send a message is you have to really come to terms with who you are as a person. Because you can make a movie about something that you don't know, but it's not going to be genuine. Mm-hmm. And because of the ungenuinity, people aren't going to get a message from it.
Yeah.
So what you do is you first come to terms with something that you are, and you really write that and nail that in the script. All the characters in the MTRS are based on me. They're all different versions of me. And so if you want to spread a message, you have to first identify what you feel in yourself somebody would want to tell you. And then what you do is you just make every little part of the movie, every little decision in the writing, creatively, camera angle, represent that message. So yeah, that's how you do it. You have to really know what you want.
It's all about like self-awareness and then putting it out for people to see
and
understand. Sweet. So your first film was Fruit Juice. How did you come up with that idea?
That movie?
Yeah.
Honestly, I'm not too sure.
It was just a story?
Well, what happened was, I think with that one, I was going the whole entertainment route.
Okay.
Where I was like, oh, I want to make entertainment. And so I was just thinking of the stuff I could do that would get a reaction. The movie has foul language. I recognize that. It's got adult themes that aren't handled very maturely. I recognize that. I was 15 when I wrote it. But I just wanted to make a movie that got a reaction. Mm-hmm. And I realized that there's a lot of dark movies out there. And when I watch dark movies, I go, oh, geez, like, what did I just watch? So I wanted to make something like that. So I just combined all the darkest elements that I knew and put into a movie. That's why it's not, in my opinion, I'm proud that I was able to make it. But the final product, I recognized that I could do better. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I was just trying to make a movie that could shock people. And so I listed all the themes that shock people and put it into the movie. That's how I came up with that idea.
Mm, nice. When you first told your parents or your friends that you'd be directing a movie, how did they react? Or did anyone say something negative, like, oh, you're too young to do this? You know, how did you react? How did they react?
With Fruit Juice?
Yeah, for Fruit Juice.
Okay. Well, my parents, my parents didn't understand the fact that it was very dark. Mm-hmm. My dad was very supportive, my mom was too. However, they at first were kind of, like, I didn't tell them there was going to be cursing, and I didn't tell them the themes of the movie. They found out in the theater.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, they were kind of like, whoa, Jonny, like, do you need psychological help? They were kind of shocked, but eventually they saw my passion in it, and they're cool with it now with the Empty Iris. Mm-hmm. With my friends, they were very supportive. They were very supportive. With strangers that I would tell I'm making a movie, they wouldn't believe me. And so, like, every week I would get at school, because really, I thought I was going to make the whole movie in a month. I don't know if I would have made it if I knew it would have taken me 2 years and trips to the hospital. Like, I didn't know that I would have made it. But I made it. To answer your question, I'm kind of going on a tangent. People would ask me, like, hey, you done with that movie? You done with that movie? Like, mockingly, in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And I would tell them, next month, next month, next month. And then finally, when it came out, they realized he actually made the movie. So there were people that didn't believe me. Now that I made it and I got it distributed, people are flocking to me for roles, and people want to be a part of it now.
Yeah. Now they want to take advantage. Okay, so you said that it took you 2 years to film Fruit Juice, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. How many hours would you put in a day?
Like, when you commit yourself to a project, like making a movie, what it becomes is you completely change, like, the chemistry of your brain and your thought process. When you wake up, it's the first thing you think about. When you go to sleep, it's the last thing you think about. And then the world of the characters you live. So pretty much, every second of the day, I would devote time to thinking about the movie, whether it was scheduling the next shoot, mm-hmm. whether it was editing, whether it was drawing out storyboards. Like, every amount of energy that I had goes into making my projects. And it's also why I get sick when I make each one of my projects, too. Mm. So to answer your question, I'm not going to say 16 hours a day, because that sounds pretentious, but pretty much, like, it's all I think about.
Okay. And what would you do in order to to remain motivated? Like, did you ever regret starting the movie because it was a lot of work?
Oh, that's a good question. I never would regret it. I would if I didn't want to be a filmmaker. I would obviously regret it. But I understand that it's the work that I have to put in order to get to the top.
Yeah.
And the way to stay motivated is to make the movie as big as possible. With Fruit Juice, there was times where I would take breaks. I would just go, like, I can't do this. I'm just going to go to the gym for a week. But still it would be on my mind, nagging at me. And people who saw me start it would nag at me. However, with The Empty Iris, what I did was I put together a 40, 50-person team. And they're all expecting results. And so now that's how you get motivated. People texting you, when are we going to shoot? Realizing that on social media, I'm putting results. Like now people are waiting for it. So a good way to stay motivated is to set yourself up with a network and team where they just expect results. I'm not saying pressuring yourself is a way to stay motivated. However, it is a way to get the work done. The best way to stay motivated is to stay passionate, which means really realize why you're doing it. And coming back to the terms of Fruit Juice being entertainment, I was passionate about it. I was. However, with The Empty Iris, it's 100 times more. Because when I write the movie, when I see the actors act out my problems, like it's like therapy for me. Like, mm-hmm. I wrote all the characters as me, and now I'm seeing it come together. Sometimes I'm sad and I'm editing, and then I realize that this character I put in the movie to address that problem, mm-hmm. and I hear myself through that actor speaking, and I'm like, wow, like, I just got the answer that I needed. So pretty much the way you stay motivated is to work on something you're very passionate about. And if you're not passionate about it, put yourself in a network of people and in a position where you have to be pressured to finish it. Just set yourself up for success when you're starting a project.
Mm-hmm. So it's like you're telling people, is it like credibility? Like, if you put out, I said in an email once, I'm gonna put out a video every month. It's like, now I have to do that. I can't back out.
Exactly.
So how did you find your actors for The Empty Iris? Oh, by the way, The Empty Iris is Johnny's second film, and he just finished it last week.
Yeah, with the Empty Iris, the actors. With Fruit Juice, I love the actors. You guys are good guys. however, they don't want to be actors. I pretty much got my friend and said, hey, I'm making a movie. You're going to be in it. That's pretty much how I did that one. And so, basically, by me saying that, the experience wasn't very fruitful. Like, it was hard getting these guys together. Mm-hmm. I would be canceled on. I would get a film shoot canceled 5 times. Then the 6th time, everybody would show up except one person. It would be canceled again. Like it was hard. Like, it's not easy getting to where you want to be. However, if you stay committed, that's how you get it. The good thing about The Empty Iris, however, was once I had the credibility of Fruit Juice, people wrote in emails to me. People still write emails to me. Just a couple weeks ago, a composer from Vietnam, mm-hmm. like saw my Facebook post about The Empty Iris, and now she wants to compose music for me. Like, it's all about putting in the hard work at first, and then eventually people realize that and see that, and they flock to you. So the way I got my actors was people started hitting me up after Fruit Juice, and then what I did was I highly evaluated whether they were reliable or not, because I mean, you're not paying them. They could back out at any moment. They could. And so you have to be aware.
I hadn't even thought about the money.
I'm not paying anybody. And so when you meet with them, you have to look in their eyes and you have to see, are they going to be with me for a year and a half to get this project done? And the actors that I chose this time, I'm glad I had a good judgment of them. They all performed with flying colors. They were there when I needed them.
And, they're professional?
Very professional. And also friendly, so which is good.
So what's The Empty Iris about?
The Empty Iris, synopsis-wise, I guess I could say, it's about a blind philosophical teenager named Adam Homer. He's played by Beto Ochoa, a very talented actor. And Donnie Hamrabi, his best friend, played by Slim DiCefalo, again, very talented actor. Slim DiCefalo, Donnie Hamrabi, he takes Adam Homer to a party because Donnie Hamrabi has a very cynical view of the world, very pessimistic. Thinks the world sucks and whatever. And then Adam Homer, he's blind, and he believes, however, that the world is great. And this guy, Donnie, he says, I need to protect you. I need to make you more street smart. So I'm going to take you to a party, and I'm going to have you experience what the teenage lifestyle is, because Adam Homer is very sheltered. What ends up happening is he gets kidnapped at the party. He gets brutally tortured by a mysterious group of people. Mm-hmm. And now Danny Hammurabi wants revenge because he feels really guilty, of course, and he wants revenge for those guys. So that's his little plot line. And then Adam Homer's plot line is that he's really looking into the world and seeing, is the world really as beautiful as I thought it was? So it's a very introspective, just it's dialogue heavy, a lot of monologues about what life is and stuff.
Well, I'm excited for it. I saw the trailer. It looks really trippy.
Oh, yeah, it is very trippy. A lot of dream sequences that mean a lot. Everything in the movie, I purposely put there for a reason. Every single word.
Yeah.
The color of a shirt. Like, I really paid great attention to detail onto making this movie mean something. Mm-hmm. So you could analyze it, like, for days.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how did you manage to get... Because I know you got... Fruit Juice into the theaters, and then you got it onto Amazon Prime recently. How did that process work?
For the theaters, I was, like I said, like it's all about telling people what you're gonna do, and then finding a way to get there. Like honestly, like in regards to entrepreneurship, like most people, they lay back on the cliff and they build the plane and then they jump off and fly it. The people that actually get somewhere successfully, people that jump off the cliff and figure out how they're going to survive. And so that's what I did at Fruit Juice. I told everybody it's going to be in theaters. It's going to be in theaters and it's going to be on I told everybody it's going to be on Netflix, but it got on Amazon. So, but you tell people these things. And eventually what I did was I did the research, and it turns out that to get it into theaters cost 10 grand. And I'm like, you can't do that. That's hard. Regal wanted 10 grand, AMC wanted 10 grand, maybe even 12. And so I hit up a friend who knows San Diego a lot. And now he told me some very indie theaters. And the Ken in San Diego was one of those theaters. And so I called them. Turns out it's only like about $600. So it's way less. And if you charge for tickets, I made it free because I want people to go and experience it for the art. But what I did was I did my research. I found the areas that I could play at. And indie theaters are great for playing things you just rented out. You can sell tickets to raise the money. Amazon, it was just doing a little more research. There's a company called Distribur, which you could partner with, and they sell your movie to places. But, yeah, it's all about really, like, knowing the market. Mm-hmm. You have to learn about it.
Yeah, and talk to people.
Yeah.
So, because, like you said, you didn't have the 10 grand to get your movie into the theater, what did you do in regards to money? Like, what would you do if you didn't have it?
If I didn't have money for a film production? And the Fruit Juice or the Empty Iris?
Both.
For Fruit Juice, we needed no money because we shot everything. And like, here's one thing for aspiring filmmakers. If you're going to make a movie, and you're going to write a screenplay, keep in mind that it has to be shootable if you're going to direct it. Like don't write a movie about going to Paris and blowing up buildings if you don't have the budget for it, or else you're never going to make the movie. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be your excuse. For 10 years, you're going to say, I have a great screenplay, I have a great movie idea, just don't have the money yet. Mm-hmm. What you have to do is you have to write around your budget. So for Fruit Juice, I had no budget. What I knew was that I had four friends who would be semi-willing to commit to a movie, and that I had an apartment building who was open on Sundays. So I just wrote a movie around those resources. Mm-hmm. And that's how I was able to handle the no money thing, because I never needed money. I went into their closets, and I asked them what they would want to donate to the movie. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the Empty Iris. However, the Empty Iris, my parents actually put money into it because they saw the potential for Fruit Juice. Okay. When it comes to money, I do everything I can to not spend it. Locations, I've never paid for a location. I've never paid actors. I've never paid people. It's all about using your resources wisely. There's always somebody who's going to have what you need. And if you use the right words and you talk to them in the right way, they'll let you use those resources too. Mm-hmm. For example, I film at two mansions in the Empty Iris. Like, one of the mansions was closely related to the guy who directed Clint Eastwood's Son. And so, like I'm filming at these prestigious mansions. And if you were to rent them out, it would cost thousands of dollars a night. However, what I did instead was I found out who knew these people who owned these mansions. And I just talked to them, talked through them, set up dinner meetings, and just talked my way into letting me film at their house. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's all about finding out your resources, because you live in a great world. Life is freaking amazing. Mm-hmm. You have so many opportunities. You have so many resources at your disposal. Like in San Diego, you have no idea who you're going to meet. And if you just... Okay, I'm on a huge tangent.
That's fine.
I'm sorry. Anyways, I do everything I can to not spend money. It's all about meeting the right people and using the resources you can at your disposal. And if not, finding the resources, because there's always a way to get a resource you want. There's always a way.
Yeah, because people, a lot of people don't do the things that they want to do because they'll find excuses, like yes. They don't have money.
Exactly.
But it's all about building rapport with people and finding a way to communicate.
Exactly, because there's always somebody out there that's going to have the resources and capital. If you walked outside right now and you met Bill Gates and you had the best pitch and you had the best impression, and you just really like had a personal connection with him and you built a friendship for a year, like, who knows, he might want to pay for your college education. He's super rich. There's somebody out there that has the best capital and all the resources you need. You just need to find a way to communicate with them, honestly.
Yeah, because like people will meet celebrities, and it's like you're missing, if you have this big dream and you're just meeting them just because you're a fan, like you're missing this whole opportunity to create something bigger.
Yeah, exactly. Like there's always a way to get what you need through verbal contact.
Yeah. So how did people react to your first film? Like, did anyone say anything discouraging? I just see on Amazon Prime that someone left you a 1-star review.
Yeah, just last night I got a 2-star review. No, honestly, my whole idea about that is like, I mean, those people, obviously I don't care. That's the first thing. And I don't just say it. I'm not just going to say haters going to hate.
Yeah.
They are going to hate. But like, but obviously, like, I just don't care because in every one of my projects is a portion of my life. Like, pretty much what they're saying is that what I worked 2 years on, what I went to the hospital for, because I would have panic attacks and I would get anxiety attacks, and I recently got stitches for the MTIR because I had one of those attacks. Those 2 stars are basically them judging 2 hours. In reality, I mean, I put 2 years of my life on that. It's so easy for someone to text and write stuff. What it's not easy to do is gain success and put yourself out there. Mm-hmm. So if you just focus on the fact that, here's a better way to answer that. The people who are discouraging are going to be verbal about it. They're going to write things discouragingly. They're going to write hate comments or whatever. However, what the artist and what the creator can't forget is that there are so many more people rooting for you.
Yeah.
Like, you have, like, no idea. Like, those 2 people, they wrote bad comments. But at school, at the weekend after the premiere, the week after, I went back to school, everybody gave me high fives. Everybody shook my hand. Everybody gave me smiles. Mm-hmm. My whole family is in love with the fact of what I'm doing. I get comments on Instagram. I get met at school saying, hey, you're the movie guy. I'm really inspired. Like, what you can't do is you can't let the small amount of haters really take control of your thoughts, because there is a huge network of people who really are rooting for you. They just don't say it because they're too afraid to compliment people. Mm-hmm. But there are so many people rooting for you. You have no idea. Like there are so many people rooting for you.
Yeah.
You know, and what you do, just they're not verbal about it. The haters are the ones that are verbal about it because they want the attention, because they don't get it, because they don't do what you do.
Mm-hmm. They're insecure about the fact that you're over here following your dream, and they're probably over here at home watching movies all the time.
Yeah, exactly. And so, I mean, you nailed it. Mm-hmm. You can't forget about the people that are rooting for you. There's always a support team. There always is.
Like, yeah, you've really gotta work on that, because I think by default we're just always focusing on the negative, no matter how small, and then we just forget about the big positive things in our life.
Yeah, exactly. Just the fact that you're creating something is positive in itself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So how do you get into your creative process, like? How do you get into your thinking zone? When you have an idea, do you just like write it down right away, or?
Yeah, I have like notepads and stuff. Whenever I think a lot, that's one of my faults. I live in here rather than out here. Mm-hmm. That's one thing that I'm trying to change. I recently took on salsa dancing and surfing. And so I'm trying to explore myself more in the world.
That's great.
Yeah, thank you. But I mostly live in here. And what I did for most of high school is I just lived in there. Now I live in here and I write down all my thoughts. So I'm constantly texting myself or writing on a notepad, an idea that I have for a conversation, an idea that I have for a character. And then what I do when I'm starting a project is I just read through that. Because everything that I write down is personal, obviously, because it came from my mind, it came from my emotions. Mm-hmm. So I just read everything and I realize, okay, based on this, I'm honestly really unfulfilled in my life. And I think that I have a lot of source material for that. I think I can make something really genuine. So I'm going to make a movie about that. Mm-hmm. So it's all about really jotting things down about yourself and then later on analyzing it, and a movie just appears. Really, like, the brain is one of the greatest creations in the universe. It is. Like the amount of matter in here, like, it's creating consciousness. Like, that's crazy. Like, that just the atoms whizzing here is creating consciousness. And so what I mean by that is it's the greatest supercomputer ever. Mm-hmm. If you question within your mind constantly, what's a good movie idea? What's a good movie idea? And just keep on doing it. Eventually, your brain's going to come up with an answer. So it's all about having a dead-set mindset on creativity. So, for example, the way I came up with my third screenplay that I'm writing, I started thinking, like, constantly in my head, what's a good twist for a movie? What's a good twist for a movie? What's a good twist for a movie? What do I care about? What do I care about? And eventually, I was eating cereal one day, and I wasn't eating cereal. I was doing something monotonous. And out of nowhere, like, my brain just rushed in with just projectiles of scenes and characters. And it was because I was, like, charging myself up. Mm-hmm. So it's all about constantly meditating on the fact that you want to be creative. And your brain will answer you. That's why people get depressed. They focus constantly and they ask themselves constantly negative questions. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And their brain gives those answers.
What you put out, you get back?
Exactly. And what you think about, you get. Mm-hmm. Honestly. I really believe that your thoughts shape the way the universe reacts to you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, besides all the filmmaking, what do you like to do for fun?
That's the thing. I don't know.
You're trying to figure that out?
Yeah, you have no idea. I mean, like, legit, like, I've devoted myself so much to film. Mm-hmm. Like, everything. I don't hang out with my friends. Mm-hmm. I've never had a girlfriend. Just recently, I started watching movies again. I hadn't watched movies for a year and a half, or Netflix for a year and a half. Uh-huh. I didn't do anything for fun. Mm. Like, that's the reason why, like, I would faint, like, out of nowhere. Like, I would collapse.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And stuff. So, that's a good question. I'm still trying to figure it out. Hopefully salsa dancing, hopefully surfing, because that's what I'm trying to do now that I'm done shooting the movie.
Yeah, because that's actually something that I talk about. I probably mention, like, every blog post. I think that someone should do stuff for themselves, at least dedicate 30 minutes to an hour, like, whatever it is. If it's, like, I build puzzles if I'm bored. Because, yeah, it helps me not think about anything.
Yeah, I'm trying to meditate. Yeah. I was going to meditate in the car actually before the interview, but I realized I was going to be a little late, so I'll meditate after. But yeah, uh-huh. I've been trying to meditate. That's really good.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm actually just learning about that too.
It's weird because, like, when I don't meditate, I see the world in a red tint. Mm-hmm. Like, legit, like, visually, like, everything's in a red tint. Like, right now, like, things are just, like,
it's light.
Well, not even that. Like my daily like life, like, it's in a red tint. Mm-hmm. However, when I come back from meditation, like, when I open my eyes, everything gets a blue tint, a clear tint. It's weird.
How,
like,
yeah.
Maybe
okay. So this is the last question before we get into this new segment that's called the Be Rebellious Take Control segment, and it's got four questions. So before we get into that, what's your advice for aspiring filmmakers? What's some tips you have for them?
The best is to, like, do it. Because so many people ask me that, like, how do you make a movie, Jonny? How is it possible? Like, I'm not being pretentious here. I don't want to say that what I do is impossible. Anything is possible in life. Anybody, there's a kid who's 14 who probably could have 4 or 5 movies on Netflix. Like, I don't doubt it. But what I'm saying is, like, you have to actually do it. Like, everybody wishes they could do something, but nobody puts in the work. Mm-hmm. They think everything's gonna be handed to them. Like, it's hard work. It's hard work doing what I do. I got into a car crash because of, like, how, like, I mean, I'm not gonna be negative. I'm not gonna list all the things, but it takes a toll on you.
Yeah.
You have to just do it. You have to completely, like, devote yourself. You have to raise the standards of your life to the point where, like, you realize that it's just a must. Like, it's not. It has to be a
need to do
it. It has to be a need. It has to, like, I lost 30 pounds in 3 months, these past 3 months. I lost 30 pounds. And it was because I had to shoot the movie. Mm-hmm. Over I had to eat. Mm. That's what it was. Usually, it's you have to eat. I made my goal. I have to make this movie. And so, I didn't eat. Like that's what it has to be. Like, in order, especially at this age, and with no money, it's the only way you're going to get things done. You have to make things a must. And so, to filmmakers, to anybody in general, just, you have to make things a must in order to get where you want to go.
And it's such simple advice. Just do it, and, like, you see it. It's a cliche, and yeah, it's a cliche that people read it and they're just like, Yeah, I should, but then they just ignore it.
It is. So let me make it actionable then. Because that is true. It is a cliche. I don't want to be cliche right now. Mm-hmm. To make it actionable, hang out with the people who want to do the same things you want to do. If I did not have best friends who completely want to devote their lives to acting, I would not have gotten the empty iris done. Mm-hmm. The fact that I had friends who had wanted to be actors since they were young was the reason why I was able to get the empty iris done, because they pushed me to get it done and I pushed them to get it done too. Mm-hmm. So an actionable step you can take to become a filmmaker is to make friends with your crew or a crew that you need. Find a guy who likes to do mic stuff and sound. Find a guy who likes to do cinematography or has a camera. Find a guy who really loves to act. Like, legit, he actually loves doing it. Go to your drama school or drama department in high school and make friends with these guys. And then eventually, after you're really close and you've bonded, say, hey, I want to make a movie, and then make it. At that point, it'll be a lot easier than you trying to find the resources without having a place to start from. So that's an actionable step you can take.
Sweet. Okay, so let's get into the Beer Bellies Take Control segment. So the first question is, what is one thing you love about yourself and one thing that you want to improve upon?
One thing I love about myself is that when I set my mind to something, I do it. That's something that I'm not going to back out on. It's something that I completely know. One thing that I can improve on is balancing my life. Right now it's all work. It's been all work for the past 4 years. So balancing the good times. Because I know when I'm 90, I'm going to regret not being young.
Not being a teenager.
Exactly. That's one of the lines in that movie. So that's something that I need to improve on. And that's why I'm taking salsa dancing. Like, yeah.
So it goes back to that. In your opinion, what is the best way of showing self-love?
The best way of showing self-love. Mm-hmm. The best way of showing self-love, honestly, is figuring out who you are. Not who you are, figuring out what you are right now in the moment. And by that I mean like based on your actions, based on what you do all day, based on who you hang out with, based on the way you portray yourself to people, you're creating a persona of who you are. And you need to find out who that is right now. It might be that you're lazy. It might be that you're really anxious. And the best way to show self-love is to figure out what that persona that you have created for yourself is, and then create something that you want to be, something that you aspire to be, and then do everything in your power to get to that point. That's how you show self-love, because you are becoming the person that you want to become. If every decision that you make, you're becoming a man or a woman, or what, you're becoming somebody. And you have to make sure that that somebody that you're becoming with those decisions is somebody that you want to be. So that's how you can show self-love, making the right decisions to benefit yourself.
That's great advice. I totally agree with that, doing the discovering yourself and then just doing what you want.
Yeah, no, definitely.
And the third question is, what has been your biggest effort moment so far?
Effort? Mm-hmm. My biggest effort moment. I mean, that's a good question. Let me think. Can you give me an example, honestly? Because I want to answer your question.
Yeah, if...
What has been your biggest effort moment?
My biggest effort moment. I think, honestly, probably making my first YouTube video, because I'm really private and I keep everything to myself. So making a video and putting it out for the world to see was extremely, nerve-wracking.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. So making that was probably my biggest effort moment so far.
You said, screw everybody, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
Okay. What's my biggest effort moment? My biggest effort moment was me starting to write my third screenplay.
Really?
Yeah. I was like, everybody was telling me to calm down and relax. I said, F it, I've already got a good role going. Why not keep it up? So I guess
that's good.
Yeah. I could think of a better one later, and if I do, I will tell you.
All right. Yeah. And the last question is, in your opinion, what is the first step to taking control of your life?
The first step to taking control of your life is I don't wanna plagiarize, but I read a lot of books on self-improvement. And the biggest step from those books, and which I agree on too, I'm not just repeating something I don't agree, is to raise the standards of your life. Tony Robbins says it. This guy, Charlie Hooper, who recently hooked me up with a video class online, he does Charisma on Command, shout out. He said the same thing. It's about raising the standard of your life. Like, in your head, or on paper actually is better, figuring out what you want your life to be and make it a must. Like I said earlier, make it a need that you have to wake up at 4 a.m. to hit the gym. Like you have to make it a need. That's the first step to making decisions in your life. However, in reality, just simplifying it, every decision that you make affects your life and affects your overall destiny and trajectory of your life. So to take control of your life, you have to make the decisions correctly. So it's all about every decision you make. Every single decision you make, whether it's brushing your teeth, whether it's going to school early, late, whether it's deciding to hold off on a project, all those things are decisions. And if you make the right decisions that benefit you, you're going to take control of your life. If you constantly make the bad decisions, whether it's to view the world negatively, whether it's to not go for the run in the morning that will get you positive, whether it's to not smile when you want to smile because you, for some reason, are just so shallow, you just don't want to smile. Those decisions affect your life. And if you make the right ones and you make the correct ones, you will take control of your life.
Nice. Yeah. So that's the end of the interview, but do you want to tell people where they can find you on social media?
Yeah, sure. You could find me on... well, I'm not going to advertise myself, but I'll advertise my movie. The Empty Iris, it's on Instagram, at The Empty Iris. I have a website, jonnysantanamovies.com. And on there, you could just find my projects, links to my work, links to pages where you can donate to my work. And yeah, I'm sure there'll be like a little text box.
Yeah,
you could just go to the link.
All right, well, that's it for the interview. Once again, 18-year-old director Jonny Santana. I hope you guys really enjoyed it and that you look forward to more. So thanks a lot, Jonny.
Thank you for having me. Yeah.